Praise the Lord. So therefore, Ephesians 6, verses 13 and 14. Put on God's armor, complete armor, that you may be able to resist and stand your ground in the evil day of danger. And having done all that the crisis demands to stand, stand firmly in place. Stand therefore, hold your ground. Having tightened the belt of truth around your loins and having put on the breastplate of integrity and of moral rectitude and right standing with God. Last week, I believe I had a fresh word from God. I'm going to remind y'all about it just a little bit as we get into today's message. The armor of God sometimes is a cloaking device. It hides me from the enemy. Sometimes the command is given, hold your position. Sometimes the command is given, just stand your ground. Sometimes the command is given, don't move, freeze, lest you give away your position to the enemy. And I believe that that is a revelation for the times that we're in right now. I came to tell somebody today, if you would do more fighting like this, you would have to do a lot less fighting like this. We fight in the realm of the spirit. This armor is spiritual armor, obviously, not physical armor. And sometimes, many times, I believe more times than we've realized, the armor keeps me, hides me, as David wrote in Psalm 27:5, for in the day of trouble, he will hide me in his shelter. In the secret place of his tent will he hide me and set me up upon a high rock. He tells me, you won't even have to fight. I got this. He tells me that he will cover me. He will hide me under the shadow of his wing. Jesus said, in this world you're going to have trouble on every side, but be of good cheer. I have overcome it all. When God hides me, fear will not be able to find me. When God hides you, rejection won't even find you. Despair will not find you. Bitterness will not find you. The thief won't be able to find you. The burglar won't be able to find your house. The smooth-talking dude won't be able to find you, ma'am. Oh, yeah, there's one. Some of you ladies need to be hidden until time for your revelation to come to the right one. The loose woman won't be able to find you, sir. Boy, Lord, I love how they're shouting now. Wow. Bring it down to where we live, right? Oh, Lord, hide my family. Hide and cover my children. Hide my marriage. Hide my business. Hide my house, my cars. Hide my various account numbers. Hide my finances. Hide and cover my health. In the secret place of your tent, O Lord, hide me. I know I have been spared from evil so many times over my life. I have learned to say, thank you, Lord, for hiding me. Thank you, Lord, for hiding this church. Thank you, Lord, for hiding my health. Thank you, Lord, for hiding my finances. Thank you, Lord, for hiding my children. Is there anybody else besides me in this room thankful that God hid you? He hid you. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. Sometimes God will say, just stand over here in the shadow and let me hide you until the storm passes by, until the enemy passes by, until the ambush passes by. Hallelujah. When God hides you, no devil in hell can find you. No, the devil does not even want to play hide and seek with God. I can tell you that, because he will lose every time. When God hides me, cancer will not find me. When God hides me, depression cannot find me. No thief. When God hides me, no accusation can find me. No offense can find me. No poverty can find me. For in the day of trouble, he will hide me in his shelter. In the secret place of his presence will he hide me. So I am sure that I'm sure that I'm sure. The armor of God is a cloaking device. It hides you away from the enemy. Now, 24 plus years ago, God put in my spirit to start a church, to plant a church. He took me to the vision and the calling of the prophet Nehemiah. And Nehemiah's great cry and great like branding phrase of his mission to rebuild the walls of the city of Jerusalem was, "Let us rise up and build." And there is a principle about the battle that I want us to look at in Nehemiah. I have not read from this in years. And we need to be reminded of our foundation right here, because it speaks to this principle. So Nehemiah, by the way, who was not a minister, not a clergyman, not in the priesthood, not of the lineage of Aaron. He was a servant. He served the food to the king as they were in captivity, a Babylonian captivity, and he had to taste the food lest somebody was trying to kill the king. That was very common back then, to try to kill the king with poison. He was brought into the court of the invading king, of the barbaric king, and he served his food, and God spoke to him and said, "I'm going to call you out, raise your..." See, this is something, honey, you spoke to that earlier. God is going to have to go outside of the ranks of the clergy. He's going outside the ranks of the clergy. People like me are going to stand on the sidelines cheering on the next generation. They're going to accomplish so much more. They're going to do so much more greater things. And I can't wait, I can't wait, I can't wait to stand there and cheer them onward. That's a role for this generation. My generation and older, cheer on, push forward the next generation. They're not going to be clergy. God's going to call them out of every walk and every avenue of life to reap this final harvest. And Nehemiah and his mission, his call, is such an example of it. So now, here we go. He's giving out assignments. They're trying to do the construction on the wall. Let us rise up and build. Now, again, his cry, his statement, his vision statement, his mission statement from God was not, "Let us rise up and fight." It wasn't, "Let us rise up and fight. Let us rise up and build." Because let me tell you something. If you are building something for the kingdom, the fight will find you. If you are doing something that makes a difference, the fight will find you. There's a principle here I want us to get. So he said this, Nehemiah chapter 4, verse 11. Read along, we'll see it on the screen. "Also our enemies said, before they know it or see us, we're going to be right there among them and we're going to kill them and put an end to the work." The devil's mission is to stop the advancement of the kingdom of God and the kingdom of his Christ in the earth. And churches that are not building the kingdom of God in the earth may be big and rich and bigger and whatever, whatever, whatever. If they are no threat to advancing the cause of Jesus, if they are advancing their own cause and their own agenda, there will be no fight against them. The devil will leave them alone. But if you're building the kingdom personally, in your own home, in your own business, in your own finances, your own family, the fight's going to find you. They said, "We're going to come in among them. They're not even going to know it. We're going to ambush them." Verse 12. "Then the Jews who lived near them the enemy heard them. They told us 10 times over, wherever you turn, they will attack us. There's fear in their own camp. Verse 13, Nehemiah speaking, therefore, I put some of the people behind the lowest points of the wall at the exposed places, posting them by families with their swords, spears, and bows. After I looked things over, I stood up and I said to the princes, to the nobles, the leaders, the officials, and the rest of the people, don't be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome. Fight for your families, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your homes. So then, Pastor, they did have to fight. You just read they got swords and spears. So they had to fight. Hold on. Verse 15, when our enemies heard that we were aware of their plot and that God had frustrated it, we returned to the wall, each one to our own work. Look at this. From that day on, half of my men did the work while the other half were equipped in armor, spears, shields, bows, armor. The officers posted themselves behind the people of Judah who were building the wall. Those who carried materials did their work with one hand, held a weapon in the other. Now, I used to preach this like you can get the victory with one hand tied behind your back. They had a hammer in one hand, a sword in the other. They're working on the wall. They got the sword ready for the fight. But follow this now. Verse 20. Wherever you hear the sound of the trumpet, join us there. Our God will fight for us. Now, I read on. Long time ago, but I've refreshed my memory again. There never was an ambush. The enemy never attempted anything. They were prepared. They had the battle gear, the armor on. There never was any ambushes. It's all just empty threats of the enemy because Nehemiah made sure they kept the foe. In other words, Nehemiah didn't say, oh, stop. Stop the building. Stop the construction. Stop advancing the kingdom. Stop building the kingdom. We've been threatened by the enemy. No. He said, we are not going to allow the work of God to stop. We are not going to allow the building of the kingdom of God to stop. Just because the devil has threatened, he's going to attack, ambush, thwart, try to shut us down. And there's no record that anything ever happened. God fought the battle for them in the realm of the Spirit. There was no fight that ever happened. That is such a principle for us today because we fight this way too much more than we should when we should be fighting this way on our knees and on our faces before God. The weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The weapon of homosexuality is nothing up against the power of Almighty God. And if God decides, I will deliver him or her from homosexuality in an instant, he will do it. He will do it. Hallelujah. I hear the Lord saying again, and I pray you hear what the Spirit is saying. You will not have to fight. You can stop fighting. Stand. Take your position. Freeze. Don't move. I've got this. I've got you covered. Stand. Father God, you are my hiding place. David said in Psalm 32, verse 7, you are my hiding place. You will protect me from trouble. And here's a point I want to make today. Surround me with songs of deliverance. Now, Pastor Jerry was up here using the word deliverance earlier. If you've been delivered, if you've experienced a deliverance, we want to know about it. Fill out the card. Let us know. We stand with you. We have places for you to grow and to walk in that freedom and to stay delivered. You surround me. Do you even realize that what Pastor Jamil and this worship team is doing every single Sunday is there is always somebody here that needs to be surrounded with a song of deliverance. Hallelujah. That's the power of worship. Ephesians 5, Paul tells us, we don't look at this often enough anymore. Be careful then how you live. Ephesians 5, 15. Not as unwise, but wise. Wise. Making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. He could have pinned that right now in August of 2015. It could not be more appropriate and applicable to a generation than it is for us right now. Making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Make the most of every opportunity to give God praise. I said, make the most of every opportunity to give God praise. Make the most of every opportunity to serve someone. Make the most of every opportunity to forgive. Make the most of every opportunity to love. Make the most of every opportunity to lead. Make the most of every opportunity to let your light shine, because the days are evil. Oh, how Paul's words here are so very relevant to this generation, this time, right now. Be careful then, he's saying, how you live, not as unwise, but wise, making the most of every opportunity because the days are evil. Let's go on. He doesn't stop there. Therefore, don't be foolish. Stop the foolishness, but understand what the Lord's will is. Do not get drunk with wine, which leads to horrible things. I'm trying to help our translator. I know what you see on the screen there. Instead, be filled with the Spirit. Speaking, look at this, to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord. Always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Speaking to one another in psalms. Man, I am so glad that God was so very deliberate to give us a hymnal. He gave us a song book. He gave us a praise and worship book right in the middle of the book. The book of Psalms is praise and worship music. And it's the book of Psalms that is still the book that is sung to this day in the body of Christ across the world. Speak to one another with psalms and hymns and songs from the Spirit. Sing. Now, David also just said, you hide me, Lord, hide me, Lord. You surround me with songs of deliverance as you hide me from the enemy. If I'm telling you, music truly does move the soul. It moves the heart. Anointed, Spirit-filled music moves the soul in the right direction. The same way, unanointed, godless, Billboard top 10 will move the soul, all right, in the wrong direction. You know what? I don't remember the Bible lessons when I was in Sunday school as a child. I don't remember the Bible stories, except the ones that were set to music. Okay, now I'm going to go, this is a throwback right here. I'm going back right here. Under 50, just put your ear, this is a throwback right here. I can remember the message of the gospel through the songs I learned at 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 years of age. I have not sung them in 40-something years, some of them, But as I was studying for this message, all of a sudden I got to that. I wanted to make this point, and the lyrics and the melodies just rose up from somewhere in my hard drive, storage disk, backup file, time machine, whatever you want to call it. And I remembered, if you're saved and you know it, say amen. Amen. If you're saved and you know it, say amen. Amen. Zacchaeus was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. I know all these under 40 is looking like, what in it? Pastor, you're having a flashback. Do Lord, oh do Lord, oh do. Oh, do Lord, oh do. You see what I mean? The rain came down and the floods came up. The rain came down and the floods came up. The rain came down and the floods came up. And the house on the sand went flat. That's the word of, that's here it is, the gospel. Sing and make melody in your heart unto the Lord. Somebody, you have prayed and nothing happened. You went to the Bible study and nothing happened. You went to the conference and nothing happened. You went to the prayer meeting and nothing happened. You got the counsel of this one or that one and nothing happened because you have lost your song. Get your song back, because in your song just might be your deliverance. Hallelujah. Your life has a song. Your testimony has a song. Your healing has a song. Our faith has a song. Your deliverance might just depend upon your song. And he brought forth his people with joy, and his chosen ones with gladness and singing. He brought them forth with joy, and his chosen one with gladness and singing. He surrounds me with songs of deliverance. Hallelujah. Man, if there was only one gift, only one gift. If there was only one gift from God that God has placed in my life, I am thankful every day for the gift of song, for the gift of worship, for the gift of music. I can tell you right now that I have been through things that would have destroyed my life, but I kept on singing. I kept on singing. I have faced things that I've had no theological answer for, but I refused to stop singing. I have walked through things with other people that I had no words for, but I was able to give them a song. Well then, Pastor, why is it that you don't sing anymore? You pass that on to Pastor Jamil. Don't you think for one moment, my friend, that I don't sing anymore. There is a keyboard in my office, and there are many times that I get up from my desk and I sit to the keyboard and I face the wall and I sing my song unto God until the burden lifts off of me. Keep singing your song. Don't stop singing or it's all over for you. I sit there and I sing until peace floods my soul, until joy comes over me, until the burden of the day of the life of ministry is lifted off of me. Somebody in here, you're going through something right now, and the Bible study, the prayer, the book you're reading, it just didn't happen because your deliverance is locked up in a song. Hey, Silas, I know we've just been beaten with 40 lashes. I know we've been falsely accused. We've been thrown in the inner part. We've been thrown in solitary confinement here, Silas, but I just don't know. There's something about this situation, and I feel like singing. Silas probably thought, have you lost your mind? My back's on fire. Uh-oh. Look out! Come on. Don't look at me. I'm not about to sing. I would never sing when you can hear this.
I feel like going on.
Wow.
I feel like going on. The trials, they may come.
Yes, the trials come. Thank you. crowd joined in the attack against Paul and Silas, and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely beaten, they were thrown into the prison. The jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in stocks. At about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was a violent earthquake. The foundations of the prison were shaken, and at once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. Because of a song in the midnight hour, because of a song when you had done all to do to stand, you stood there for, and you still kept singing your song. Hallelujah. The earthquake came. Now, there's several interesting things here. Everybody else heard them singing a song. Well, I know what she was just diagnosed with. Look at her up in that altar just singing and dancing before God. I can't believe that. She ought to be depressed. She ought to be upset. She ought to be blaming God. She ought to be home petting that thing. She ought to be home laying on that mat still. No, no. Sing your song. Sing your song. I don't promote country music, but there's a country music song about that by Martina McBride. Look it up when you get home. Sing it anyway. If nobody here, sing your song anyway. Don't let anything or anyone or any situation or any pain in your body or any report from the doctor or anything the employer says or anything the bank statement says or anything your stock report says or anything the news says steal your song. If you stop singing your song, it's all over. And there's some in this room today you had stopped singing your song. You've been praying. You've been reading the Word. You've been in the Bible study, the prayer group, the church service. You've been paying your tithe, but you stopped singing your song. And God says, I'm trying to surround you today with songs of deliverance, that as you sing your song again, God will begin to shake that thing. He will surround the thing that has you surrounded. God will intervene supernaturally without explanation and bring deliverance to you. Hallelujah. Well, Pastor, you don't understand. I can't carry a tune. That's why I don't sing. That's why I don't get to church until about 11:15 every day, because every Sunday, because I don't sing. I can't sing. So I just kind of wait till that. No wonder you're the way you are. You know, there's an entire genre of music. It's very popular. It's called rap. Now, I don't like it because you don't have to carry a tune to rap. But it's acceptable type of music to the music industry. So if I was to demonstrate for you how a white boy from Alabama, my wife is hiding, she's going under the seat, crawling under. I want you to understand, you don't have to sing on key or be able to carry a tune to sing your song to the Lord. Speak it. Get some. You offer it to God as a song. It's the most beautiful thing in all of the world. Into His ear, He'll stop the choir of heaven to hear you sing your song off key, off pitch, out of tune, off beat, out of rhythm, out of time. But if you'll sing it to the Lord, He will receive that song. Oh, how beautiful are you, Lord. It's your words, it's your words, it's your love, it's your love. It's your word, it's your love, it's your love, it's your word. I need a baseball cap, put it on sideways. I forgot that. Oh, how. Oh, how glorious, glorious. Are you Lord? Are you Lord? Are you Lord? It's your word, it's your word, it's your power, it's your power, it's your love, it's your love. You saved me, rescued me, saved me. Just a moment there, just a moment there, just a moment there. Set me free, set me free, set me free, set me free. Now, you don't have to carry a tune to sing your song to the Lord. And they will enter Zion, the prophet Isaiah said, with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them. You know what? I'm learning something about singing your song. There's a direct relationship, a direct connection to your joy and your song. They're related. They go together all throughout Scripture. Gladness and singing, joy and singing, victory, excuse me, and singing, deliverance and singing. It goes together. Sing your song. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow will flee away. No depression, no despair. It will flee away as you begin to sing your song. Your healing might just be in the song. I know some of y'all, your joy is locked up in a song. Your word of direction just might be tied up in a song, because God surrounds you with songs of deliverance today. You have prayed, you have given, you have tithed, you have fought, you have served, you have read the word, you have sacrificed. All that is left for you to do is to find your song again and start singing it unto the Lord. It will bring a shaking. It will bring a violent shaking to every sin, every weight, every pain, every addiction, every ambush, every accusation, every lie of the devil will fall off of you like the chains that fell off of Paul and Silas and everybody in the prison. Somebody in here needs to understand, when you start singing your song, there are prisoners around you. Prisoners here around you. What in the world? And as they hear your song, something's going to begin to happen to them. They're going to find their song again, and chains are going to start breaking off of everybody every time we come up in this place together. Get your song back. Get your song back. Make melody and music in your heart to the Lord. Hide me, Lord, in the secret place. You surround me, Father, with songs of deliverance. Can we pray? Father, songs of deliverance. Jamil, would you come? You might have a song. You might have a song. Songs of deliverance, songs of freedom, songs of healing, songs of peace. Lord, some received a deliverance as we sang songs of deliverance a few moments ago. But Lord, I can't wait till next Sunday. I got to get my own song. I got to make music and melody in my own heart. I got to keep singing to my own self, my own spirit, my own soul. Songs of freedom. Oh, songs of peace and rest, songs of health, joy and strength. As we worship, let's stand together. Can you just sing, "Here I am worshiping you"?
Worshiping you.
Oh, yeah. Get your song back.
I am.
Somebody got their song back. Somebody, let me hear. Did anybody get your song back today? Did you get your song back? Did you get your song back? Keep singing. Keep singing. Keep singing your song to the Lord. Thank you, Father, for the power of music, for the power of the song. You surround us. You sing over us. You dance over us. You rejoice over us with singing, your word says. Thank you, Lord, for the song of my own deliverance. For the song of my deliverance has come today in the name of Jesus.
Thank you so much for being a part of our online church family today. I know God has spoken a fresh word into your life, and we celebrate that with you. If you would like to contact our church, leave a prayer request or a comment, please go to our Facebook page or to our church website and do that. We would love to hear from you. If you are ever in the Palm Beach, Florida area, we would love to have you worship with us. Our worship services are every Sunday morning at 10:30 a.m., and we invite you to come if you are ever in this area. God bless you.